Let's see the different steps of installation. It is assumed that you've installed the compatible Oracle version and you have the hostname port number, of course, the default one, 1521, or your customized one, and the SID, service ID, or the connection string for your Oracle installation, which you have done. And you've also made sure that you're able to connect to the database with your system account. Let's go to the installation steps now. As you can see here, this is the Linux version of version 10.2, and it is in the tar format. I mean, it is zipped using the tar. So the first step is to untar this file to the location on which you want to do the installation. So whenever you're doing it, as this is a huge file, use this command tar-xvf, which is to untar all the files in it and give the name of the file. It'll do the unzipping or untarring of the file. And if you see these dots here, that's the process where it is trying to unzip or extract all the files in it. Okay, so it seems to be stuck in between, but notice these dots, those keep moving. If these are moving, that means the work is happening. So don't cancel it. Let it get unzipped. Okay. And the license file is also needed. So make sure you copy the license to the same directory where you have the files extracted. And wherever you see these white spaces, that's something which I have overwritten to make sure that I'm not showing my folder structure, which will confuse you at a later point of time. Just take the key aspects of it and then proceed with your installation, right? So what did we do till now? You have the Linux 64-bit tar file. You've downloaded it from Informatica PowerCenter website, uploaded it into your Linux box, either using PuTTY or Tektia client or whatever is your preference. And you've used the tar-xvf function to extract all the files, and you're copying your license file also to that directory, right? Now, before we start, let's also find out what is the default code page, which is set on the Linux box, which is UTF-8, which is fine. That's what we want. You also need to identify what kind of different data sources you have and if UTF-8 works with all of them. Even if you're not aware of it right now, you can proceed with this step. There are other ways you can fix this at a later point of time. Now, the next step is to identify a file called install.sh. Once you identify that, you run the installer by invoking install.sh. Now this installer will take few minutes to initialize, but whenever you get to this screen, do you want to continue? Just say yes, which means you just have to use your keyboard and type Y on the keyboard and hit enter. The moment you do that, it'll prompt you if you're doing the installation of Informatica or upgrading an existing version, or you're doing install or upgrade of data transformation engine only. Let's not worry about data transformation engine right now. We are doing the installation part. So you'll select number one from the keyboard and hit enter. So in the next step, it will do the pre-installation checks. There is nothing which you have to do. It'll take its own time. And as we have gone through the prerequisites already, and if you have the right Linux box set up with the right infrastructure as part of the installation and configuration document or the guide, you can just wait for it to prompt and give you these options, all these three, and you'd select three. Wherever you see default, that means you don't even have to type it. It automatically selects that. All you need to do is hit enter. So once you hit enter, it'll prompt you for its terms and conditions. Here, you might have to change it because the default is set to one, which is no, but the system is making sure that you have read it and you have accepted it. Okay, you change it to two here and hit enter. So once you hit enter, the installation process actually starts. Notice here again, default one is selected, which is nothing but install Informatica services. Select this option to install Informatica 10.2.0 service. Notice it also gives you an option to install EIC, Enterprise Information Catalog. Like I said, if you have the license and if you want to install it, you will select two. Of course, post Informatica services installation, only then you'll start with Enterprise Information Catalog. All right. It defaults to one. All you need to do is hit enter. Do you want to enable Kerberos network authentication for the Informatica domain? Default is one. Just hit enter. Okay. Then the installation steps start. Okay. It just gives you all these details that The minimum disk space requirement is 13 gigs, memory is 6 GB. Those are the database requirements, and it has done all these steps as it shows, and press enter to continue. So you'd press enter to continue. The moment you do that, it'll ask us to provide the license information. We've already copied the .key file or the license file. You just need to give the path to it. Okay? And once you give the path, you hit enter. And this is the pre-installation summary. It is just showing you whatever it has identified till then. And you just need to press enter to continue. Then the installation happens. It just shows you all these prompts till it is 100%. So once all the files are copied, we'll be prompted to the next step, which is step 5A of 9, which is nothing but the domain creation. Now, here is the choice where we create the domain. You'd select the default one, which is create a domain, and then you select default one again for enabling secure communication for the domain, and you select 2 to disable the HTTPS, and you select 1 to enable SAML authentication. Wherever I have pointed the arrows, wherever you see the selections, I missed an arrow here. There is one there as well. All these, I am going with the default installation, assuming I am doing it on my personal Linux box. But if you're doing it at the enterprise level, these are some of the things which you need to verify beforehand and enable them. Of course, there are options to enable these once you go with the default installation as well, but that requires the command line and you need to know how to do all that. So the main thing in this is default one here, create a domain, disable HTTPS, and disable the SAML authentication. All right, click next. We are in step 5B of 9. Here you will choose what server. Remember, one of the assumptions which I made is that you already have Oracle installation done and you're giving the database user ID, which is infadomain, which is nothing but a username which you create on your database. If you have not created it, you can leave the screen now, log into your database and use these commands, create user, infadomain, identified by, give a password, and give those two username and password here. Database connection, you'll go with the default one. Database address, you have to give the host name of your Oracle server. This is Oracle server, not the Linux. Or if you're doing it on your personal PC, you can use the local host. Give the database service name here. For me, I'm using XE. If you've installed a full version, then you would get the service name as ORCL or whatever you have configured. You have to use that. I don't know if you're able to see the last one. Configure the GDBC parameters. It says two options, yes and no. The default is 2, which is no, and you'd click next. Okay. Now in 5C, this is where we are prompted to provide the encryption keys. Okay. There is some write-up about what this encryption key is. You can read about that. Give an encryption key. Make sure it is saved in some place which you can refer to whenever that is needed, and hit OK. Now we are in step 6. In step 6, domain configuration is already done. In step 5, domain underscore dev. Now we need to configure the node along with certain things of domain. So name of the node, I'm using the default node 01. Domain user is administrator. That's a default again. You can give the domain password and enable SAML authentication. We've already said no to it earlier. We'll say no to it now. Display the advanced port configuration. No, I'll go with the default port 6005. I don't want to do anything on advanced port. And it's already prompting me, do you want to configure the repository service and data integration service? I'll say yes, which is number one, if you're not able to see it. And here, node host name is the host name of your Linux box. It's not Oracle, it's the Linux host name. And if you've installed Oracle on the same Linux and also Informatica on the same Linux box, you can use localhost as the name of it. And if you're doing it on your personal PC, you can also use localhost, right? Now, once you hit enter, it'll do all these steps. This might take a little time. And here, since I chose to configure the repository service, in the next step, which is 7A, it is prompting me different things to configure it, right? So it's asking me what database type. Obviously, I'll go with Oracle. What is the database username? Infa MRS, right? That's the username which I've created for model repository service. Is it a secure database? Yes, no. default is no, I've selected no. If you say yes, it'll ask you further on what are the secure details which it is configured with and how do you want to configure. JDBC is the standard. We'll go with the default option. So once you do that, again, it will ask you for the host name. Same thing again. If it's Oracle, you'll give the Oracle service host name. If it's your personal installation, you'll go with localhost and the default port number 1521 and the database service name. I'm going with the XE version. You can go with XE or the full service name, whichever you have given there. In 7B, this is where you give the names of your MRS. MRS dev, DIS dev. And we are going with the standard HTTP. And it'll just do the creation, enabling, and updating of the modal repository service. All right. Now, this steps after updating the modal repository service, it'll create the data integration service and update it till it is enabled. All these steps might take time based on the infrastructure you have. If you're going with a very basic of, let's say, 6 GB RAM and 50 GB hard disk, things might be slower. Or if you're using a virtual machine on your Windows PC, or if you're using a Red Hat Linux virtual machine on your Windows PC with some allocated memory on it, in the initial phases, it'll be a little slower. So just be patient, let it do its job. We're almost done. Post-installation summary, step 9 of 9. It'll show you if it is a success or not. If it has failed, it'll show you the log. Also, all the steps from step 1 or step 0 are all noted in this directory here. And that'll be your port name, and that's the default port number. Hit enter to continue. That's the last step of your server installation. All right, so those are the steps which you need to do for a Linux installation. Whatever steps you see on 7, 6, 5, whatever we have seen from number 1, in Windows, it's almost the same case, but you do that using your mouse, and you can see what's happening during the installation. Those are the installation steps on the Linux machine.